Riverbend is a 1989 drama with action elements that seems to have all but completely fallen through the cracks of history. I feel the need to clarify that it's a drama with action elements because the marketing for this film would have you believe that it's pretty much a straight action film. And while the third act is definitely action-packed, two-thirds of this film are actually pretty much an out-and-out drama dealing with race relations and segregation in the mid to late 60s. It can get pretty harrowing at times, which really caught me off guard in all honesty. I thought I was getting into something akin to the American Ninja movies or Cyborg Cop, but what surprised me even more than the fact that this movie is actually quite well done as a drama is just how few people have actually even heard about this. The film languishes in relative obscurity with only 94 ratings and even less in the way of actual written reviews on IMDb at the time of recording. There's only a handful of images from the film on Google Images, quite a few in low resolution, and even a cursory Google search mainly brings up regurgitated or recycled plot outlines and only a single-digit number of actually independent written reviews. While I can't hand on heart say that this is the most obscure movie I've ever spoken about on this channel, I'd feel pretty confident in saying it's definitely one that's been in the wilderness for a while. The film is set in Georgia in the year 1966 and takes place primarily in the small town of Riverbend. At this time, the American South was a hotbed of racism and revolution. Martin Luther King was a prominent figure in overseeing the change of living conditions and the rights for black people across the country, and civil unrest was becoming more and more prominent. Riverbend is a town set in its ways, and the segregation, racism, and horrific attitudes towards people of different ethnicities is being upheld and proliferated by the town's police department. Sheriff Jake and his deputy are absolute bastards. I cannot mince my words here with it. They're just awful. They feel entitled to kill black people, the sheriff regularly touting that the only good nigger is a dead nigger. They destroy black businesses and terrorize the black community, including attacking and raping anyone they're in the mood to attack or rape. The film opens with family man Marcus deciding that enough is enough and that he intends to put an end to the sheriff's tyranny by taking concrete evidence of the sheriff's crimes to the courthouse as proof of the sheriff's improper behavior in an attempt to get him put in jail. Before he makes it to the courthouse, however, Sheriff Jake catches him, accuses him of resisting arrest, and guns him down mercilessly. We then cut to several police cars and military vehicles escorting a prisoner to be court-martialed. Inside the prison wagon are Major Samuel Quinton and two of his men. All three are recently returned from Vietnam and are being court-martialed for disobeying orders. They're also very likely to have an unfair trial as a result of the orders they refused. So with some quick thinking, they start a small fire in the prison wagon and escape out into the woods, eventually arriving at Marcus's house where his wife Elizabeth and their son are mourning their recent loss. After some light persuasion, they initially force themselves into the house to avoid being caught by the police, Elizabeth decides that it's probably alright to have the guys stop at her place for a couple of days as they can help do some tasks around the house and they can help keep the place secure in case Sheriff Jake turns up looking to get molesty or murdery. After some time of working around the place, Sam and the guys eventually get a feel for exactly what's been happening in Riverbend, and they're utterly shocked at the way the white people of the community are treating the black people. So they begin to devise a two-pronged plan to try and avoid any more abuse. It's a difficult plan, but if it works, it'll stop any further punishment for going on the run from the court-martial, and it'll get justice and equality for the black people of Riverbend. They decide that if they can get enough people on board, train them up with the knowledge of fighting in Nam, arm them, and storm Riverbend seizing control of the town, that the press and the FBI will turn up wanting to know what's happened, allowing them to expose the corruption of the town and get their unfair court-martial quashed in one fell swoop. Things really start to kick into high gear when Sheriff Jake heads over to the local black nightclub called Fat Man's and decides to just fuck with their shit for fun. He goes in, demands everyone leave the premises and be home before 10 p.m, almost no time at all as it's nearly 10 p.m. when he calls it. He tells the owner of Fat Man's that he's to permanently close the club and never reopen, and when one of the youths in the club challenges the sheriff's cruelness, he knocks him out before kidnapping a girl and driving her to the outskirts of town to molest her. Weirdly, this film actually picks that point back up in the third act to explicitly say he didn't rape her, even though all the other dialogue heavily implies that that was the case. Anyway, with the black members of the town nice and riled up, Sam and his men decide to engage with some of the locals and manage to convince them that taking over the town is a good idea. This causes a mass outpouring from the black community, who line up behind Sam and begin army-style training in preparation for the nighttime raid. Meanwhile, Sheriff Jake and his deputy begin to suspect something's going on and raise it to the town's mayor, who dismisses it as being highly improbable. After a few days, Sam has a highly trained army ready to go, and that night they head into the town locked, stocked, and ready to rock. They seize control of the police headquarters, lock Sheriff Jake and his deputy and the mayor all in local cells, round up all the white people in town and herd them into the local church, and contact the nearest police station to tell them that Riverbend is now under Sam's control. The cops laugh it off and send a couple of troopers to investigate, but when the troopers arrive, they realise quite quickly that Sam and the townsfolk aren't messing around, and soon enough, the whole thing escalates, with state troopers and the army drafted in to try and quash the rebellion, while Sam and his men hold the town and continue to demand equality against ever-increasing odds. As tensions rise and time ticks on, both sides begin to become sloppy, and a few small mistakes result in some pretty heavy-hitting deaths. With time running out before a bloodbath set to happen, can Sam and his men change Riverbend for the better, or will Sheriff Jake have the last laugh? This one's been sat on my shelf for a while, and because I thought it was just going to be a generic action film, I always kind of passed over it for weirder or more interesting titles. But what we have here with Riverbend is a very well crafted, if not slightly flabby movie that has a lot to like, with only a few wobbly bits that could pretty easily be remedied. First and foremost, the script's pretty decent. The dialogue is all fairly believable for the most part. There are times where it straddles the line of coming across as a little hokey. I've no qualms with it from a pacing or structuring perspective. The first act is quite gentle in introducing the characters and their intentions, while the second act helps to amp up those characters' motives into a pretty high-paced third act. It didn't exactly have me running out into the streets to shake people to beg them to watch this one, but it had enough entertaining moments and nice character pieces to help carry me through from titles to credits. Do I think it could have been tighter? Absolutely. This film runs to around about 96 minutes with no cuts that I know of from the BBFC, and I reckon you could probably take another 10 to 15 minutes off with almost no effort. I feel that even if you took those 10 to 15 minutes off, it would result in a vastly improved and overall tighter film. While it's rarely if ever boring, there are just some scenes that kind of feel like they're there just because. Which isn't strictly a problem, but it did bother me that with just a little tightening up here or there, that this film's script and pacing could have really popped rather than just being alright. One of the biggest issues I have with this, from a script perspective, is exactly where to place it in terms of genre. I would say two-thirds of the script are basically just an out-and-out drama about persecution of minorities in the mid to late 60s, but then the third act turns a little bit first blood with the Naaman action sequences. So there's definitely an action movie influence, but then there's also a bit of blaxploitation present as well, with several notable tropes being present throughout, such as most of the white people being stupid or evil, one token white guy being an aide to the cause, Major Sam being a strong, no-nonsense black guy with attitude who comes in and helps overthrow the oppressive white people, gratuitous fight scenes that get quite bloody. There were some scenes here that really channeled Truck Turner and Welcome Home Brother Charles. I mean, had this film been made 10 years earlier, it would have probably just been an out-and-out blaxploitation film. And personally, I'd have rather the more grisly blaxploitation elements of this film been toned down or removed entirely, as they do seem a bit like they're just here for the sake of audience satisfaction. For example, did I need to see a fat old racist man get seven shades kicked out of him by a Marine? No, but had they not done that, then the sheriff probably would have been seen to get off too easily. And so we have this incredibly weird sequence that doesn't really gel with the rest of the film tonally. I mean, it's a bit of a slap in the face to this film's message of don't give racists the satisfaction. As it stands, well, it's a bit of a hybrid of all these genres and more. which makes it quite difficult to categorise and even more difficult to recommend to people. Because who is this film actually for? The action nutters will get a bit fed up that there isn't enough explosions here until the final act, and the drama folk won't much care for the gratuitous third act shootout. I suppose if you can appreciate it for what it's trying to do and you don't go into it with a fixed idea of what it is in mind, you'll probably come out thinking, much like me, that it's just a good, solid work, but nothing that warrants putting on a pedestal. The script was written by Samuel Vance, and this was his only writing credit. He did the screenplay. He was really more of a producer for TV, having produced the mostly forgotten Brady Bunch spin-off The Brady Brides, and as soon as I read that, I kinda realised what Riverbend's script reminded me of. It felt like a TV movie, one of those slightly harrowing, based-on-a-true-story types. But it was shot with a cinema budget. I'd probably do a disservice to the movie by saying that, because it's definitely more entertaining than most of that kind of schlock, but its DNA is definitely made up of some TV-related materials. It's just got that vibe. On directing duties, we have Sam Firstenberg, who you'll no doubt be aware of as an old hand of the action and martial arts genres. He worked quite closely with Cannon on movies like the American Ninja series or Breaking 2 Electric Boogaloo, while also branching out beyond Cannon with films such as Cyborg Cop and Ninja 3 Dominion. In total, he has 24 directing credits, and from what I've seen of his work from previous reviews on this channel, check him out if you're interested, I like him. He's a steady pair of hands. Which is probably why I think the direction of Riverbend is just that, a good, solid, steady work that again, doesn't go above and beyond, but at minimum has a good, solid whiff of quality behind it. There's nothing outstanding here, though I do have to credit his work in the action sequences and in the establishing shots used throughout the film, all of which are delightful and have quite the sense of grandness about them, but it just never quite gets to must-see in terms of getting that vision down. It does have a little bit of a problem with maintaining period authenticity. This film's supposed to take place in 1966, but frequently there are sequences that have a really strong early to mid 70s vibe about them. It does struggle at times to keep the viewer immersed in the period it's supposed to be based in. More on that later. I don't know. It just kinda seems to struggle at times to escape the aforementioned TV movie vibes, which is a bit disheartening. I'd say at worst this film's direction and feel is just about passable in terms of shot structure and visual realisation. At best it's just short of noteworthy, it's consistently okay. Which I think is partly why it's been forgotten. Because in this day and age, good and solid very rarely draws people in. Adding to this, the cine at times is rather flat. Most of the dialogue scenes are simply backing and forthing, and the shots, for the most part, really don't have a sense of any depth about them. In fact, barring a series of crane shots that play as establishing shots over the town of Riverbend whenever anybody enters the city, most of these shot setups are just a bit bland. I just feel with a bit more planning on framing choices and a bit more of a directional push with extras to get a bit more animation and movement into the backs of shots, we really could have seen something special. Instead, well, it's just a bit lifeless in places, which is a shame. The only other significant problem I had with this film lay with its soundtrack, which is very much a game of two halves. Around 50% of the film is scored perfectly. It's got a soulful and ever so slightly swinging quality to it that perfectly captures the music scene of the time right before the creative freakout hit that was 1967 onwards. It's smooth and gentle and hits all the right notes. It's a great incidental instrumental run. The problem is, from around the second act onwards, just as the action element of the film starts to get going, the film forgets what time it's supposed to be based in, and instead we get a thick, flaky slice of pure 80s synth arse that just destroys any sense of time or placement. It's cheap, nasty, tinny, it feels like it was recorded on the fly, and it just ruins any sense that this film is supposed to be a period film. To the point that for large swathes of the second and third act, I had to constantly remind myself that I was watching a film set in the mid-60s, and not some kind of American Ninja spin-off. With some very minor rescoring, this film's production values probably could have been massively boosted. But instead we get cheap and cheerful, which only goes to exacerbate the cheaper elements of this movie even further still. as if the script and Cine weren't doing enough to hogtie this thing at times. Mercifully, we are saved by some pretty decent performances. I'd say around 80 to 90% of the cast are pretty much on the money. There are a couple of extras who are maybe a little too stilted in their delivery, see the banker, who's easily the worst actor in this movie, but for the most part, we're looking at an exceptional set of performances here. This was Steve James's first proper attempt at breaking out of the sidekick role that he was regularly pigeonholed into. And I think he does a pretty decent turn here. He's stern, tough, and no-nonsense, but not aggressively so. He rarely loses his cool. The definition of speaking softly and carrying a big stick, if you will. And through the film, there are some really lovely moments where he opens up about his life in the army, and in particular, a great scene where he has a moment of doubt about whether he's doing the right thing, resulting in a pep talk sequence that really lets him show a decent range. And I really wish he'd been given the lead in more movies, as I think here, given the script he's working with, he aces it. Tony Frank gives a sterling performance as Sheriff Jake too, being an out-and-out arsehole with such relish that he's absolutely unmissable in almost every scene he's in. I mean, I wanted him dead pretty much in every scene he's in, but that's how perfectly he nails that snivelling, poisonous, egotistical arseholery that racists often openly boast these days. He performs perfectly, and though some may think he maybe goes a little bit too pantomime in places here, for my money, that just makes the performance all the better. Margaret Avery too has a really fantastic turn as the widow-turned-love interest Elizabeth. The script really gives her a full spectrum to work with: joy, passion, blistering hatred, sorrow, the works. And she nails every performance, just absolutely nails it. In particular, there's a scene near the end where she has to talk someone out of shooting the sheriff, and she handles it perfectly. She gives just the right balance of believability to the character, and while she doesn't immediately impress out of the gate, I guarantee if you watch this movie, she'll be the one to grow on you. Riverbend was released on VHS in the UK in 1989 by Prism Distribution. I'm not 100% certain if these guys are the same Prism who went on to found Prism Leisure in the 90s and 2000s, but I wouldn't be shocked if they were. This is the kind of movie they would generally put out, so it makes sense to me. The picture quality on my copy is fine enough, though I did notice intermittent sound issues on my copy. The film slowly got quieter and quieter as it went on until the scene where the sheriff goes to the mayor with his suspicions, at which point there was a pop sound and suddenly everyone was super loud. It's probably just my copy, but I thought it was worth mentioning here. And since then, Riverbend hasn't been seen since, which I just find really weird. Like, if it was a bad movie, I could understand, but it's actually half decent. It does need a Blu-ray release sooner rather than later, in my opinion, as I think cleaned up with some half-decent extras, this one could be a real hoot. Riverbend isn't a perfect film by any stretch of the imagination. Some yawn-worthy cine and a real issue with keeping the film in the decade it's supposed to be set, married to a script that, while good, is maybe just a little on the flabby side, really holds this film back from being great. And that's a shame, as I think with just a little bit more TLC, this really could have been a stellar movie that was up there with some of the greats. Despite those points, however, what we have here is a decently written script with some really nice performances and direction that, while not perfect, succeeds way more than it fails. The OST may end up being the deal breaker for you on this one, but to me, if you're looking for a movie to sink an hour and a half into that's just a bit different to your usual run-and-gun action fodder, try Riverbend. It's kinda, sorta, good.